from Muncie, Indiana, home of Ball State University's Center for Information and Communication Sciences, welcome to Myths, Models, and Realities, Creating a Campus of the Future. This video conference, which is being received in three countries by over 800 institutions, was produced by the Center for Information and Communication Sciences at Ball State University. It was made possible through the generous sponsorship of AT&T, Ball State's partner in creating the teaching environment model of the campus of the future. Co-sponsors for this video conference include the American Association of State Colleges and Universities, the American Association of Community and Junior Colleges, the United States Distance Learning Association, and the National University Teleconferencing Network. Hello, and welcome to Myths, Models, and Realities. I'm Bob Perkins, and we are in the new state-of-the-art home of the Center for Information and Communication Sciences at Ball State University. I will serve as your tour guide as we take a look over time and across the nation at the growth of an idea for making the opportunities presented by the information age work better for faculty and students on campuses across America. The Campus of the Future concept began in Pittsburgh, my hometown, in 1983. It was the brainchild of a frustrated business and communications professor who was tired of having things electronic not work in his classroom. He happened to also be the assistant provost for the University of Pittsburgh and interested in making the whole campus work better. But you'll meet Dr. Steele in a few minutes. The Campus of the Future model idea has grown since 1983, and in one form or another, it has traveled and evolved with the help of campuses throughout the nation, some of which you will visit with us today. But first, let me be a good tour guide. I'm standing in the main hallway of the second floor of the new Edmund F. Ball Communications Building, the home of the Center for Information and Communication Sciences and its voice, data, and video labs. The center led the teaching environment model of the Campus of the Future project here as one of its service projects. It is the academic home of the Master of Science in Information and Communication Sciences graduate professional program, which it began in 1986. It also operates an applied research institute, laboratories, and a campus-wide faculty development program for the campus. The building and the center were made possible by a $10 million appropriation from the state of Indiana in 1985. There are some interesting things around us which I thought you might like to see as we make this brief introductory trip leading to the content of the conference. For example, there is a special attitude here about learning which the center and the architects have demonstrated in this hallway and in the overall design of the building. It is called passive learning, and it involves surrounding visitors, students, and faculty alike with information age learning opportunities which help to demystify some of the technologies. All along the serpentine second floor hallway are information and communications company histories and historical pieces tied to the evolution of technologies and the industries they have impacted. A museum-like display from Indiana Bell Telephone Pioneers featuring the history of voice communications with telephone instruments dating back to 1876 and Alexander Graham Bell's first experiments was one special highlight of the opening of the building last fall. In order to eliminate some of the mysteries of the technology and to encourage involvement on the part of building residents and guests alike, the video, data, and voice labs are glass-lined, and guests and sidewalk superintendents alike are welcome to watch without disturbing anyone. This is the voice lab. Each of the labs has hands-on applications, which are present in the latest Campus of the Future model, as well as leading-edge tools not yet operating on the campus. We clearly are in the midst of the information age, and education in communications has certainly changed a bit since I was at Northwestern University. But it is time now to get on with our trip. While I go next door into the teaching environment model of the Campus of the Future visitors room, I would like you to meet Mr. John Smart, Senior Vice President of AT&T. Mr. Smart.
Hello. I am pleased to welcome you to this special event to represent AT&T in the sponsorship of the Myths, Models, and Realities Video Conference for Higher Education. This event and AT&T's partnership in creating projects, like the teaching environment model here at Ball State, are ways in which we at AT&T concretely demonstrate our commitment to education and to higher education in particular. In the information age as we know it today, it is essential that whenever possible, we combine our talents and experiences with critical user populations in pursuing solutions to information movement and management problems. You know, it's a little ironic that I should be speaking to you today from this unobtrusive video classroom at Ball State. It has but one piece of AT&T equipment apparent in it. However, this special room does operate within an integrated system on an infrastructure tied to a network which is based upon open architectures and access that is critical to the free flow and convenient flow of information throughout our nation, no matter whose equipment is involved. That is basic to our business. Perhaps one of society's greatest challenges today is to prepare its young people to learn how to use the tools of information technology. Our country's competitive position in the changing world will depend more and more on this technology. It is incumbent upon the institutions in which our students are educated to provide the modern information age environments conducive to the mastery of this key competitive arena. I hope that you will benefit from this video conference today. Clearly, each institution will have its own ideas about what might appropriately constitute a campus of the future environment on their campus, and that's fine. What really matters is that by sharing progress today, you may be stimulated to plan improvements for your campus tomorrow. With that tomorrow in mind, AT&T is continuing to invest heavily through the Bell Telephone Laboratories in the technological underpinnings of information movement and management, like photonics, like the Integrated Services Digital Network, artificial intelligence, and all forms of local and wide area data networking. Our experience and our innovations have been and will continue to be readily available to you. Clearly, we do not have all the answers ourselves, but through a partnership of interested universities, faculties, and students, we can come up with meaningful directions to continue pushing the leading edge of this information frontier. It's great to be with you representing AT&T. I hope you have a great conference. Bob, back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Smart, and welcome back to an unusual facility. This is the visitor's room, specifically designed for the Ball State project. Should you visit, you will find represented here almost every basic working application involved in the teaching environment model of the Campus of the Future project. It also serves as a classroom and meeting facility for the center's faculty and students. You can look from this room directly into the voice, data, and video labs where smaller versions of switches similar to those operating the campus network are available to students and for industry training programs. Even the furniture in this room is part of an ergonomics research project in cooperation with Steelcase. As you can tell, a good deal of thought has gone into the design of this integrated facility. A similar amount of care went into the design of today's conference. Let me preview the events to come and introduce you to the host. The conference was designed to provide as much access for audience interaction as is possible. Each major segment has time reserved for you to phone in your questions. This 800 number on your screen will get you through to a bank of operators who will take your question, and we will respond on air to as many as time permits. When that is not possible, we will take down your question and information on how to reach you and either answer the question later in the program or see that an appropriate individual gets back to you. We will also keep a special line open for additional questions after each segment is finished. When possible, that number will appear on the screen, but you may wish to note it here. Guests will go back to the visitor's room where a speakerphone will allow you to ask a few more questions of those who are off air. The conference will not shut down for a lengthy lunch break. The time differences simply make that ineffective. Instead, we will take a 15-minute break about halfway through the program. We will run some pre-recorded video information during the break for those of you who are interested. I suggest that you treat lunch as an informal or brown bag event and simply break away as needed during the question and answer segment or during our official program break, as was recommended in the printed materials which your site coordinator received. Today's conference program will be broken into segments. The first segment will provide the background of the Campus of the Future model concept, and then we will take a trip across the country looking at actual working applications in projects which followed from the original model. The second segment, the leadership question, pulls together the leaders of private and public campuses, a national association, and AT&T to realistically explore the question of how one can strategically apply technology to benefit the whole of the institution. In the third segment, realities, partnerships, and business issues, we will explore how special partnerships are developed and look at the structuring of good business relationships for these projects with people who have negotiated and signed contracts for them. The original Pitt-AT&T partnership blazed a new trail, which has evolved with each new project we will explore up through the Ball State partnership. The critical issue of which applications can make a difference in the work and learning environments for faculty and students will be addressed in Realities, Applications, and the Technology at Work, a session that will demonstrate applications which flowed from the strategic plan for Ball State's teaching environment model of the Campus of the Future. How to tie in academic interests in what would normally be a campus operations activity is the subject of the brief segment on leveraging the academic opportunity. After a final roundtable question and answer opportunity with all participants available, the program will close with a look behind the scenes at how this video conference was made, marketed, and delivered halfway around the world. As you see, we have much to do, and it is time to get started. I am one of the 65 members of the Center's National Industry Fellows Program, and I am very pleased to note that a good amount of this production has been done by the Center's graduate students working cooperatively with Ball State University's media services professionals. That is consistent with the Center's philosophy of providing not only theory-based graduate education, but also hands-on professional experiences. Now it is my pleasure to introduce the individual who created the original Campus of the Future concept back in 1983. He not only gave birth to the idea, but he persevered and led the development and negotiation of the first model at the University of Pittsburgh. He then took the original model public in 1984 to help encourage other institutions to move ahead to improve their campuses. In 1985, when Ball State sought someone to turn its new state-funded building and the idea for a Center for Information and Communication Sciences into reality, they asked Dr. Steele to put his communications and management consulting business on the back burner and lead the project. Today, a class of over 100 graduate student studies in a state-of-the-art facility in an interdisciplinary academic program which has already placed numerous graduates in excellent professional positions and in competitive PhD programs around the nation. Under Dr. Steele's leadership, the Center team has adopted an interesting philosophy for these times filled with promises of futuristic technology, instant gratification, and ceaseless change. The French poet Antoine de Saint-Exupéry wrote, "As for the future, your task is not to foresee, but to enable." By his creation of the teaching environment model of the Campus of the Future project for Ball State, and his willingness to lead the task force and to serve as project director until the project was in place, he has indeed helped to enable others on campus to enjoy the benefits of a better environment in which to work and learn. By involving many of the center's students, he has enabled them to have a most unusual professional learning opportunity. I am pleased to present the director of the Center for Information and Communication Sciences, Dr. Ray L. Steele, our host for Myths, Models, and Realities, Creating a Campus of the Future.
Hello and welcome. When we did the first video conference in 1984, to share what we had learned in Pittsburgh, we had about 200 institutions join us. I'm surprised and delighted to Today we have 800 from at least three countries. Now, Bob mentioned pioneering and perseverance in his introductory comments. I'm here in our obtrusive video classroom, a polling-equipped room, which is what you saw when we opened, which is also part of our distance learning program. As a faculty member, if you walk around in this room, the camera will follow you automatically. If you punch up a seat number for a question, the student seated there will appear on the large screen and at sites throughout the state of Indiana, if you wish. The team which worked together to create this room understands that pioneering and perseverance must go together if you wish to succeed. That same lesson I learned in Pittsburgh in 1983, and again here at Ball State from the beginning of this project. We simply had an idea in Pittsburgh. We didn't have all the answers then, and I certainly do not claim to have them all for you now. But we have made some progress through perseverance and partnerships, and we will share that with you today. My secretary's son captured the essence of my sense of pioneering in this drawing. As you'll notice, the arrows do occasionally miss. After completing two pioneering projects in higher education institutions in this decade and beginning two new academic programs, I have also come to understand what well-adjusted really means. More than anything else, I've come to appreciate an attitude that is far too little apparent across higher education today as it relates to information age problems. I learned it at Pitt and had it reinforced for me here at Ball State. We can do if we dare. We have an unusual opportunity on our campuses today by taking advantage of information age technologies to demonstrate to other segments of the society around us that we can make our complex environments work better. That will allow higher education institutions to regain a position of leadership and to enhance our value to the communities we serve. We can demonstrate that we are can-do as well as can-reflect organizations. I believe that our faculty should teach and our students should learn in the best, most advanced environments possible. We should, as one of America's largest industries, set the example and create the models which other organizations can emulate. And that includes much of corporate America. Why not? Look at our talent base, if we focus it. That helps to reestablish for other segments of our society why we are valuable and worth their support. If our students leave modern learning environments when they graduate, they will go into society expecting, even demanding, more modern working environments, and they will be more valuable in their new organizations as we all work to make this country more competitive in the 1990s. If we fail to do that, many of us participating in this conference today will find our retirement much less secure. Now, I'm one of the first baby boomers. I was born January 1, 1946, and that concerns me a great deal as I think about retirement. We can find a way to improve our campus learning environments in the information age. We simply must find the will to focus on this very basic problem and to stay the course once we begin. That is the real theme of this video conference. It is a myth that campuses cannot lead with excellent electronic environments in our society. Faculty, students, and the society we serve deserve it, and it is doable today. Some of you know this by your own experiences and progress. Now let's go back in history to Pittsburgh in early 1983. Divestiture had been announced. It would go into effect in 1984. That would change the nature and cost of voice and other communication services. The information age problems faced on campus at that time, unfortunately, are still prevalent at many campuses today. I found that out this last week in talking with numerous campuses which requested a tape of this program because they had no technology to receive it on campus. Understand that to purchase such basic technology today is under $3,000. There was little integration of effort in 1983 on the campus, let alone integration of technology at Pitt, or anywhere else for that matter. The presence of someone akin to a chief information officer was generally non-existent. Everyone was happy to do their own thing, independent of others at all when possible. The basic problems were universal. Budgets were localized, and few considered the potential for holistic planning for campus information and movement problems. Computer interests were centralized and dominant. They got the money. Voice, well, it was taken for granted. Ma Bell would handle everything. She always had. And besides, telephones were just plain boring. What did they have to do with the campus environment? Video, having prematurely arrived with disappointing results in the 60s and 70s, was confusing and going nowhere. Too many administrators and faculty felt they had been burned by overpromise in the past. While satellites were up there, and even folks in the mountains like this fellow were demonstrating their values by buying receive dishes for more than likely the pornography that was available then, educational institutions were very slow to put them to use. Today, such basic technology is more apparent, but still not widely in place. However, we have made much progress here with the National University Teleconferencing Network, the National Technical University, the United States Distance Learning Association, the Tie-In Network, and many others. There was a lot of talk about the information age on campuses back then in the mid-80s, but not a lot of action. We definitely needed some different models, some imaginative new combinations to stimulate the improvements to campus learning environments, which the maturing of the information age should now make able to provide a cost-effective solution. We also needed models to help individuals and their champions on campus to believe that you could make such progress despite the bureaucratic barriers we all faced. While all of this was important in the genesis of the first model, the real issues for me were confidence, convenience, and cost as a faculty member and as an administrator. In the early 80s, I taught an executive MBA program course in Pitt's Graduate School of Business. Those students were experienced executives from some of the city's most important organizations and some of the university's most significant supporters. Many of their CEOs were my consulting clients. We had a new instructional resources organization, which I had created in the late 70s, and its new director was doing a fine job. Yet, I was one of those faculty who could not count on good service in my executive MBA course or in the undergraduate course I taught. At the same time, as assistant provost, I was responsible for a university-wide teaching evaluation unit and a faculty development unit. We simply needed to improve the institutional support for the learning environment if we were going to encourage faculty in a research university like Pitt to improve teaching. We also needed to improve access to information for our faculty, whether in research, teaching, or the administrative side of life. It was, in effect, a basic productivity issue. We needed better voice, better data, and video capabilities in the office and in the classrooms. Finally, with everyone doing his or her own thing in computing purchases, and with post-divestiture telephone cost increases looming over the horizon, we had to look to managing our information movement and management costs. All of these led to the development of the first Campus of the Future integrated model at Pitt. Since we needed help, naturally we went looking for an information age company with whom to strike a mutually beneficial partnership. AT&T was the unanimous choice of the campus task force. It was a competitive process. Pitt, like Ball State, is a public institution. Before going further, I want to establish the conceptual basis for the Campus of the Future idea. There are four basic concepts involved, but first, let me anticipate a basic question that the president of the University of Pittsburgh asked en route to close the original Pitt-AT&T partnership agreement. He asked me if we couldn't call it something other than the Campus of the Future. The name seemed presumptuous or something. But after serious effort, none of us, including him, could find another name that was easily spelled by journalists, which engaged people's curiosity and which was sufficiently broad to allow differing groups to define or interpret it to their own ends. We wanted a big idea name that people would speculate about, and a Campus of the Future was both the real opportunity and the ultimate goal. The title stuck. Now, let's set the four basic concepts in place as the foundation for the rest of the program. First, information problems are sloppy, affecting everyone, no matter what their position. That's irritating to many and a real political problem when you work in this arena. Second, good opportunities rarely exist as they have in past experience in separating and operating smaller entities. Instead, networks and volume opportunities exist today. That often suggests change to the status quo, even reorganization. Third, complexity in electronic environments holds the economic promise. From chips to fiber optics, we are doing more with fewer elements. Finally, integration is the key, first for people and then for technologies. They must work together. That indicates holistic planning and new management opportunities. Most of my experiences since Pitt have reinforced these basic concepts. They are essential to successful projects where politics, change, cost savings, and management must come together under a similar focus. They were as evident at Ball State as they were at Pitt 6 years ago. Before going further now, let me as executive producer clarify our purpose today for this video conference. First and foremost, we are not here to do a commercial for AT&T. And they knew that when they agreed to sponsor this video conference. However, the majority of projects involved today were done in open competition and won by AT&T. In the projects I have led, I've never voted. But at Pitt, AT&T was the unanimous selection of the campus task force, and with twice the number of companies competing at Ball State, the task force here again unanimously selected AT&T. The other campuses represented also had competitive selection processes. Therefore, AT&T has, thus far, come closest to meeting the Campus of the Future Concepts challenge, and they have also been willing to pursue enlightened partnerships. Now for a reminder or two. There are numerous question and answer sessions provided for you today. Ask anything you like relevant to the topic, and all participants will be candid in responding. This video conference is not copyrighted, and you absolutely may tape it. If you wish to get a tape of the conference, it will be available from the center at a modest charge. Simply write or call me at the center at this number, and we will be responsive to your requests. Today's conference is an example of research dissemination using information age tools. It is applied research. The models from Pitt to Ball State, and including many institutions in between, were based upon a theory and a set of concepts. And by sharing the results of our research with you, we hope to help others to create the next wave of advances in improving campus learning and work environments. Let me close the background segment with the definition of the Campus of the Future, which was originated at Pitt. It really represents the holistic approach to planning and integrating voice, data, and image communications capabilities within a single infrastructure, which provides the unique opportunities in these projects. The critical elements then as now include a wired infrastructure of copper and fiber optics and voice, data, and video switching capabilities on an expandable campus network which ties to outside networks. Now, as promised, let's take a look across the country at some applications of technology on campuses which have some roots in the Campus of the Future pioneering efforts. To help with this segment, I've asked Joel Hartman, Associate Provost at Bradley University, to join me in our studio. But before he does, let's go back to a co-pioneer with Pitt.
Our first applications are from
Duke University, Durham, North Carolina. One of the nation's leading private universities, Duke provides undergraduate and advanced education to a select enrollment of 9,000 students. The university is also an internationally recognized research center, conducting programs in a broad range of disciplines. Today, Duke is assuring its continued leadership in research and education.
We conducted a detailed study at Duke, and we concluded that no single technology could provide all of the capabilities we needed. So we developed a plan based on a layered approach to communications, a plan that meshed very well with AT&T's open architecture technology. At the first layer of need, we chose AT&T's digital switch to provide voice and data communications for some 14,000 users on campus.
Hello.
From administrative offices to dorms to our large medical center. At the second level, we deal with networks for sophisticated data users, most often departments within our schools and colleges. These groups have highly specialized requirements, and they need to unify a wide range of data processing equipment that has been put in place over the years. With AT&T's open architecture, we have the planning flexibility to grow and expand cost-effectively at both levels of use. We can protect the substantial investments we've made in equipment from other vendors, and we have the wide range of choices a complex organization like Duke University needs. We can keep our future options open. One excellent example of AT&T's architecture at work is in the Department of Computer Science.
In our computer science department, we needed data communications connectivity between hosts, terminals, PCs, and other equipment. We chose AT&T Information Systems Network because the ISN ties together our Unix-based system with the combination of fiber optic cable and twisted pair wiring. It not only links our department's resources together, it also gives better access to off-campus resources. With our ISN in place, students and faculty can reach a hierarchy of computer facilities from their own workstations. Now other schools and departments are joining the network, and we're developing a new synergy here at Duke.
Participating in the ISN has given us a computing capability as important to our school as our laboratory facilities. Bringing a number of computer users together on one network means we can shift databases from one processor to another, which gives us a great deal of flexibility. It also means that we can access other computers and databases, not only on our campus, but around the country. One result of our new ability is our work with the Department of Physiology and Biomedical Engineering Research. Some of our students and faculty can now work with specialized imaging and simulation programs that open new avenues of research and learning, a direct result of the ISN. The computing power it brings to our school is developing into one of our most important resources.
Work at Duke helped AT&T to improve the ISN. We'll look at it and some other applications at Bradley University with Joel Hartman in a moment. We had originally planned for Dave Binko, the Computer Center Director at Johns Hopkins University, to be with us. Johns Hopkins was a beta test site for the Information Systems Network, along with Pitt. Unfortunately, Dave was called out of the country at the last minute. He's in New Zealand right now. But to keep moving across the country, let's go ahead and make a stop in Pittsburgh with President Wesley Pozvar. This is how he described the Pitt project for the 1984 video conference.
Just a couple of years ago, our key concern on all of our campuses was with mainframe computers, and now there has been a fundamental change. We have microcomputers, small computers of great capacity that have moved to the desks of all of our professors and even our students. So the question is no longer what kind of hardware to buy, but how to access all of these various points, how to tie the whole system together. In other words, we need a network.
We've considered beta test locations at Pitt, and we've looked at Duke. Later, we'll talk with representatives from around the country, including the Oregon system. We're also going to see some tapes from the University of Dayton, University of Minnesota, the University of Windsor in Ontario, Canada, and De Anza Community College in California. That'll complete our coast-to-coast adventure. But now let's turn to the heartland of the nation. Bradley is a private university in Peoria, Illinois. I've seen some of the applications Joel Hartman and his colleagues have in place. Let's start with a tape with a little background.
Once we'd made the strategic decision and completed our final planning, we had the campus communication system in place within 6 months. We ran high-speed fiber optic cable to our major academic buildings and voice and data information outlets to all existing telephone locations. Our phone system was unified with AT&T System 85. A related modem pool gives us off-campus data connectivity. The AT&T Information Systems Network Packet Controller links host computers, PCs, and all data communicating devices on campus. And interfacing the ISN with System 85 lets us move voice and data almost anywhere we want. Before we started, we had three different phone systems on campus, and none of our computer systems talk with each other. Now, with integrated voice and data outlets in our dorms, labs, and offices, we're a unified campus. We're moving into new applications now, integrating our recruiting and admissions processes, automating registration through touch-tone phones, expanding our electronic mail system, adding a message center service. Our future holds some very exciting possibilities.
Welcome, Joel. Tell us about a couple of those projects that you've now carried forward.
Thank you, Ray. The projects that have been developed were developed after the building of our campus infrastructure that was described in that little videotape. And that infrastructure includes a campus-wide phone system, a fiber optic-based video, data network, our video system, and bringing data, voice, and video to all of our classrooms and labs. Having put that in place, we turned our attention to achieving some of our administrative and academic results we wanted from the project, and I'd like to describe a couple of those in some video I brought along. The first of our projects I'd like to show you about is our admissions office project. Here it was an example of taking an important university function, applying information age technology to it to achieve results. Let's take a look.
Okay, let's go to the tape.
Admissions office performs a crucial role in today's competitive environment. In 1986, Bradley University and AT&T became strategic partners in a project to electronically unify the campus through advanced voice and data communications technologies. This included development of an admissions office of the future, designed to enhance the capabilities of the admissions function. We began with the installation of a new campus AT&T System 85 PBX and ISN data network. Using these as a foundation, the admissions project then developed custom voice and data services. The heart of the system, an AT&T 3B2, along with integrated voice data terminals and 6,300 computers, allows staff to track students from initial contact through enrollment. Field admissions representatives have benefited greatly from the new system. What previously took several days to communicate to the field is now sent in minutes from the Campus 3B2 to all staff offices, whether on campus or in remote locations. Every evening, the 3B2 polls each representative's PC. New information relating to students in the region is downloaded to the representative's local database, and electronic mail messages are exchanged. These capabilities help not only our staff, but our prospective students as well. Students applying to a university want to know the status of their application and financial assistance or scholarship package on a timely basis. We're now able to answer questions immediately and respond to student inquiries early in the year. The ability to react quickly places the university in a stronger position of control rather than responding to what has already occurred. Performance of the system has far exceeded initial expectations and has become a central element of Bradley's successful admissions and financial aid offices.
Certainly went to the heartland when you went to admissions. Obviously, for a private university, that's at the heart of what you have to do if you're going to exist. What else have you done over there?
Well, as you know, Bradley's a private, comprehensive university. Our focus is on instruction. We have about 5,200 students, and we're integrating technology into a number of our academic programs. The next project I'd like to show you is in our College of Business Administration. Here's an example of a college that has made computing totally integrated in the curriculum, and now is following through with advanced facilities to allow teaching and learning to take place in that environment. This project tape shows our advanced function classroom.
Bradley University's College of Business Administration has fully integrated computing into the curriculum. This has created a need for greater access to computers in the classroom. In response to this need, the College of Business Administration has established this advanced teaching classroom. The facility is equipped with AT&T 6300 PCs, color monitors, hard disk drives, and a shared high-speed color printer for both students and professor. The student computers and a file server are networked through an AT&T Starlan. A gateway between this network and the campus-wide information system network allows anyone in the classroom to access a number of other computers on and off campus. The instructor's PC can be viewed by means of a rear screen color projection system. An AT&T overview scanner attached to the instructor's computer can capture images and store them in the computer or display them on the rear screen projection system. Professors can show students exactly what they need to see, which allows the students to follow the classroom discussion without deciphering chalkboard renditions of what they should be viewing on their screens. This environment facilitates the explanation of difficult concepts and enhances student participation and learning. Additional features include a sound system, VCR, slide projector, and front projection screen, all of which can be operated remotely by the professor. Custom furniture, special lighting, and twin marker boards that slide in front of the rear projection screen complete the facility. This advanced teaching classroom has enhanced students' learning experiences and has allowed professors to teach in a more efficient and effective manner.
Joel, the toughest thing I expect of what you've done, and that's really exciting stuff that you've shown us, but the toughest thing is getting faculty involved sometimes. How have you found that on campus?
Well, when we built our system, there was first of all a backlog of need for technology, computing in particular. And when we put the system in, one of the first things that happened was that backlog began to be fulfilled. Demand was already there. Once people saw what was possible, there was an increase in participation by others who were standing in the back, in the back watching what would happen with those who had taken the first steps. What we found is that our management now of the project is keeping up with demand as opposed to leading it. And we now have a program at the university to provide a personal computer for every member of the faculty and staff who needs one. We have a computer dorm project, which we'll show you a little bit later via videotape, and a number of other exciting things that are going on. But the faculty are participating eagerly and willingly, and our job now is to provide the necessary level of support for that.
Well, and that is the kind of environment I think that we're talking about today. Obviously, it's of no real benefit to put all these toys out there if they don't serve the needs of the people who were there. It's for the people we're doing the projects. Let's talk about another group of the people, and that's the students. What kind of change have you seen in terms of student attitudes in classes? Have you got any direct experiences you can share with us?
Well, the first thing to mention is that a campus's technology profile is becoming one of the decision points the students and families make when they select an institution today. And as you've seen here at Ball State and we've seen at Bradley, we've noticed a substantial increase in applications over the last several years, partly attributable to the technology profile of the campus and our residence hall of the future computer dorm project. So there's an expectation there that a university will have, will provide these kinds of things. The second thing to mention is that once students get to a university, they gobble up these resources eagerly. And whatever we provide in labs and computers and networks and our online library catalog, they use it easily, they use it gladly, and they quickly adopt it to suit their individual majors and curriculum.
You know, I was just thinking, looking at those old tapes of both of us, we were considerably younger when we started this. You think this is an aging process increase that we've gone through because of these projects?
If the gray hair is any indication, it probably is.
That's probably the case.
It's been a lot of fun.
I've just gotten some good news. For those of you who were having some audio problems, it was not your set, it was us. We had a small glitch, and apparently that glitch has been taken care of, so we're okay. Now, let me suggest that we go from your institution and move on across the country for just a little bit for this segment. Okay. I want to take you to California, to Cupertino, to De Anza College. They were out to visit us to take a look at our facilities. They're about to try a project of their own, and they came out and they're going to tell us a little bit about what they're going to do. Let's go to the De Anza tape.
De Anza College is a two-year institution located on 115 acres in Cupertino, California, the heart of the Silicon Valley. The award-winning campus was opened in 1967 and currently enrolls about 27,000 students per quarter. 750,000 additional participants are attracted by De Anza Community Services each year. It has an annual operating budget of approximately $50 million. Telecommunications at De Anza consists of a 12-channel on-campus cable system delivering student information and classroom programming, television and film instruction attracting 750 students per quarter, a community access television studio and channel voted best in the country in two of the past 3 years, a community college channel originating telecourse and other programming enrolling approximately 4,500 students per year, a teleconferencing studio from which conferences are originated, and two C and KU band receive-only satellite dishes. Like Ball State, the college recognizes the necessity of integrating its telecommunications efforts throughout the campus. And in 1991, the college will open a $15 million Advanced Technology Center. The Advanced Technology Center will place under one roof television and film instruction, satellite teleconferencing origination, microcomputing instruction, electronics instruction, computer graphics, and English, foreign language, and math computer labs.
I'm Bob DeHart, the president of De Anza College, and after seeing these clips, you might well wonder why this big commitment to these technologies. And it quite clearly is something we've planned for a long time to assist us in fulfilling our mission as a community college. Community colleges are very sensitive to local business and industry needs, to teaching, that's our top priority, and to community service needs. And these technologies really assist us in that. Being located here in the heart of Silicon Valley, they're big users and producers of computers, and of course, so are we here at De Anza. You might be surprised to find out how committed they are to video, however. Most of these companies around here use video extensively, both for customer service and their own staff development. So we try to supply that need for them, the need for trained personnel, and then community service with our access channels that we manage and control for the local cable company gets us into the community service realm in a big way. Now, all of that turns out to be reflected in our new Advanced Technology Center building, which is just getting underway. Construction is just getting underway. It's a $15 million project. It integrates in one building the uses of computers and video on this campus. We think it's going to be an outstanding instructional facility, and you're going to see quite often on your own television screens at your college or university programs emanating from the uplink that's located here in this Advanced Technology Center. So quite clearly, just to sum up, the technologies are not something we pursue just to be pursuing technologies. They help us fulfill our mission much better than ever before.
Well, whether you go from Duke to Pitt to Ball State to Bradley to De Anza, doesn't matter whether you are a private, public, a community college, junior college, the needs are becoming more and more recognized as common among us. Joel, I want to thank you. We're going to take a look at some more applications in a little while, but I want to especially thank you for going to the time and trouble to put together the tape and to come visit with us. I really appreciate you doing that.
Well, thanks for inviting us. And as you watch the different universities portray their implementations of Campus of the Future, one of the things we benefited from was our visit to your project. And we would also like to extend an offer to those watching to come visit our project, and I'm sure the other institutions would be happy to host visitors as well. It excites the imagination, it shows you what can be done, and often is the thing that makes it easy to take that next step and commit.
Well, and you really hit the right term. I think it is imagination. I think probably one of the toughest things going is to allow your imagination in projects that are multi-million dollar in scope to really take the forefront, because it's the imagination that creates the opportunity, whether it be in the technology, the application, or even the financing. They're doable. There are opportunities, there are good opportunities today that we didn't perhaps have quite as readily apparent to us back in 1983 as we do today. But I see I'm not going to be able to talk about those opportunities anymore because Bob Perkins is ready to take you on the next stop along your tour. So Bob, let's go on back to you.
Thanks, Ray. I'm in the University Media Services Master Control Room. All of the special effects and post-production work for distance learning classes are generated here by the same team of professionals who are providing this video conference today. The tape format is Panasonic's M2, the same used by the NBC network, and the range of capabilities is truly amazing, even to someone in the business. Before we turn to the next content segment, which is the leadership question, strategic applications of technology for institutional development in the information age, we should introduce the leader of the host institution today. He makes constant use of video and other technologies to inform the Indiana legislature and other Ball State constituencies. Let's go to the center's video lab and meet Ball State University's president, Dr. John Worthen.
Welcome to Ball State University. I'm pleased that so many of you share our interest in how to apply technology to improve the campus learning environment. In late 1985, when we began our discussions of what is now known as the Teaching Environment Model of the Campus of the Future Project, or TIMCOF, many of the same problems Dr. Steele has noted were present here. This is a campus of about 18,000 students. Most, about 16,000, are undergraduates. We have 1,100 faculty. We've been in existence since the turn of the century, and our mission has evolved from an academy and then a normal school to a teacher's college and finally to university status in 1965. While we engage in basic and applied research, as well as public service, our primary goal is to be a premier teaching university, offering excellent instruction for both undergraduate and graduate students. We've been fortunate that the state of Indiana has, for the past 6 years, supported a major campus project in computer competency. That has allowed us to place over 3,000 computing devices in labs and residence halls and offices throughout the campus. It's also heightened our need for a practical and effective means for tying these devices together into a network on campus. Because of our strong emphasis on teaching and learning, it also seemed very important that we find ways to encourage faculty to use technology in their classrooms and laboratories. We knew the technology must be convenient to use and that faculty must be able to depend on it. As we began exploring the TIMCOF project, and especially the video component, it became clear to me that unless we developed a modern electronic infrastructure, we could not realize the potential we saw in using technology to enhance teaching. What we needed was a focused effort to develop the kind of work and learning environment which would adequately support our faculty and staff so that we could take advantage of the opportunities that technology can provide for both research and teaching. We looked at the TIMCOF project as a means of tying together and maximizing a number of other projects. For example, computer competency, improved classroom teaching, bringing individual residence hall rooms into the computer networks, and video-based distance learning. We also found that the project could benefit our new master's degree in information and communication sciences, and at the same time be cost-effective for the university overall. But we'll have an opportunity to talk further about this in the next segment. A good personal friend and a leader in the effort to make higher education's position stronger in our society has made a special trip to be with us today, and I want to introduce him to you now. Dr. Alan Ostar is president of the American Association of State Colleges and Universities. In this role, he, better than most, has had the opportunity to see just how important it is for all of us to be as creative as possible to improve the quality of the environments in which our faculties teach and our students learn. Alan, welcome to Ball State and to this video conference on myths, models, and realities.
Thank you, John. I am pleased to be a part of this very special event. It is encouraging to see so many institutions taking advantage of information age technology by participating with us. We have a full schedule, and so I will be brief. One of our own greatest challenges as we face the last decade of this century is to learn to maximize the resources we have on campuses today. We have a new president in Washington who says he wants to be the education president, and at the same time, he must face the largest budget deficit in our history. We know that as a nation, we must improve our capacity to compete around the world as new trading blocks develop or our position in world leadership will erode. We also know that we are sitting in the midst of the most information and technology-driven period in our history, and that is shrinking the world and has intensified the need for better understanding through education. As educators, if we are not able to come to grips with the complex task of optimally applying information and communications technologies, the implications can be significant for our society. We can no longer afford to argue about whether desktop computing, networking, satellite meetings, facsimile broadcasts, and distance learning technologies will impact our campus or office. Instead, we must begin to consider whether we have planned our addition of such technologies in a fashion which positively involves our campus colleagues and maximizes the potential for information and communication in our campus network environments. The upcoming conference segment in which I was invited to participate concentrates on the strategic application of technology with institutional development as a goal. I might go a step further and suggest that if we do not improve our environments now by taking advantage of the available information age technologies, many institutions may find themselves struggling to be competitive for students, faculty, or other resources in the 90s. There are no easy answers to the complex problem of effectively applying technology to improve the learning environment. However, I am pleased that universities like Ball State and others involved today will not only take the initial risk to pioneer, but in the best academic tradition, come here willing to share what they have learned in the process with you. I am pleased to be here, and now let's get on with the conference.
Indiana has been chosen to house the latest state-of-the-art advanced communication system. AT&T has chosen Ball State University to be its partner in creating what it says will be the teaching environmental model of the campus of the future. The agreement calls for AT&T to design and engineer a campus-wide system.
AT&T and Ball State will install on the Ball State University campus an integrated voice, data, and video system, which will bring us up to the level of perhaps the top 25 or 30 universities in the country. With regard to video, which is one of the key elements for improving instruction, we think we will be the leader.
Once it's complete, AT&T and Ball State will market the new system and turn the university into what's hoped will become a national showcase of the latest technology.
But the greatest benefit will be for the students. This project will present opportunities to participate in a positive, hands-on experience with communications technology and will provide the preparation needed to meet the challenges of today's and tomorrow's information age. So again, let me say that we at AT&T are extremely proud to be in partnership with Ball State University and to move forward in the development of the teaching environment model of the campus of the future.
Our partnership at Ball State is designed to produce winners, to
to prepare special young men and women for an exciting future. And I can't think of a more worthwhile endeavor for either of us.
That was a videotape that was done at a news conference in 1987. We introduced the TEMCOF, or Teaching Environment Model Campus of the Future project. I just want to call one thing to your attention. Bob Allen, who appeared on there at the end, I'm sure it has nothing to do with his participation with our project, but he's now chairman of the board of AT&T. We're very pleased to see that happen. We have with us a very experienced and unusually qualified group of leaders to talk today. Now, Warren Bennis, in his book on leaders, says that leaders are people who do the right thing. There are others who must do things right who manage. Both roles are very critical, but they're very different kinds of roles. Today we have people in the audience, as well as on the next set, who are leaders. Their job is to look at the way the world works and to make decisions to help other people make those things happen. There was a decision that John Worthen, president of Ball State, made. There was a decision that Wes Posvar, the president of the University of Pittsburgh, made. And in each of those decisions, they allowed people a chance to fail, and in both cases, we were very fortunate to be able to succeed. The leaders on this program have also made some decisions that have allowed people to try. And I think that's really what we're trying to get the point that we're trying to get across all day. Now let's look at who's here. You've already met John Worthen, the president of Ball State University. You have met Alan Ostar, the president of the American Association of State Colleges and Universities. And of course, you've met John Smart, who introduced the program, who is the senior vice president from AT&T. We have two other presidents who have their hands in things. Actually, we have the president of Bradley University, Jerry Abegg, who has put in a project, and you heard Joel Hartman momentarily go talk about that a bit. You'll hear more from Dr. Abegg. You also have Bill Lemon. Bill was the chancellor of the entire Oregon system when they decided to go ahead, after years of looking, to make some moves in the right direction in terms of putting technology to work for their campuses throughout the entire state system. Well, let's take a minute and look at the background of decisions, especially as we talk about strategic applications. Strategic application of technology tends to cause some people to be a little bit confused, and I think maybe what we ought to do is clarify that just at the beginning here. What is strategic application of technology in the information age for? That tends to be the key question. And I think what often is the answer is what you're going to hear as we go further along here. Certainly some industry participants have learned how to apply technology strategically. And I think one of the reasons they've done that is their competitive situation is much greater, or at least they've recognized their survival based upon their competitiveness much more directly than we have in higher education. A gentleman that knows a fair amount about how business operates and what trends are going on in the industry today is John Smart. And John, let me open up with you. What are some of the trends in the industry, especially in the strategic application of technology?
Thank you, Ray. I think since the early 1980s period, when information technology became much more popular, it began to hit the literature pretty frequently. I would call the acceptance in industry of the concepts soaring, becoming much, much greater than they ever have before. Even in the organizational structures of many corporations, you'll see them combining their data processing organizations with their telecommunications organizations. Giving them a more singular control over the information movement and management functions within the company. Emerging out of that merger is usually a more singular head, typically referred to as a chief information officer. And you can count these in industry today, and every time you see one emerging, you can see another company that's committed to this information technology concept. In industry today, I think a lot of companies are grappling with a lot of the same problems that higher education institutions are grappling with. That is, there are a lot of isolated, independent applications that don't talk to each other. Companies look at the architectural platforms that they have, and they find that they don't have the level of connectivity that they need to really get the power of linked databases. So as companies try to wrestle with this. They look to people to help them, and there's a plethora of vendors that have grown up with a myriad of options that are available in the marketplace today. And I see businesses trying to sort through those options and sort through those vendors to try to find partners that they can work with, partners that will bring them competence and bring them continuity over the long run. At the bottom line, whenever you see a company embracing the benefits of information technology, it's because the leadership of that company, the top management, have embraced and understood the power of that technology in their everyday organizations. It is a matter of competition. And in fact, maybe today the reason we don't see as much publicity about some of the applications in industry is because those applications are helping with the competitiveness of individual companies, and they're a little less prone to put those in the public arena. So, Ray, I think those are some of the trends that are going on today.
Well, we may be, John, at exactly the same point that American Airlines, when they were developing the Sabre system, when American Hospital Supply, when they were talking about their applications. Maybe that's where higher education is today. We're running just a little bit behind. And maybe we are at the right time to be talking about how we're doing it so that we help others to try to do it. I suppose we'll be not unlike industry because we're competitive too, even though we wouldn't admit it. We'll probably end up wanting to back off and not talk about it so much in the next 2 or 3 years after more and more institutions are doing it. But it certainly would be good for higher education to see the environments get better. Someone who knows a good deal about environments, John, I want to come back to just one thing. We are always busily talking at Ball State about don't do as I say, do as I do. And we wonder, you know, just if you're practicing what you preach. I mean, I know you've got about I think there's still about 300,000 people working at AT&T, and you're probably, your asset base, somewhere close to $40 billion, revenues in the 30s, $33, $34 billion. That's a pretty big plant. How do you apply technology in your own house?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question. we just probably installed in AT&T and are probably still in the process of refining it. The largest data networking application probably in the world. We call it the Business Automation Platform, and it really was brought about just because we merged two very large sales organizations together. And in attempting to try to perform simple sales functions of two separate organizations, of taking orders from customers, checking inventory availability, checking installation dates, etc., we found that we had 128 separate applications running on mainframes and separate terminals for people to try to use, and just a terribly complex environment. We went at that starting in about mid-1987 and are just finishing up now. Just to give you a sense for this, we put 21,000 people behind terminals or personal computers. We distributed about 1,200 3B2 type computers. There are 200 local area networks involved, either Western Electric data kits or AT&T ISN type equipments. Two separate national networks, an asynchronous and a synchronous network. We really went at this problem, and to date, already we're seeing first the quality of work life for our people is dramatically improved. We're freeing up a tremendous amount of time where salespeople can serve customers better. It's strictly an application of information technology as we tried to surround those inflexible mainframes and tried to use distributed processing.
Did you say 21,000 people? That's just about our student body and faculty and staff size. You're just about 1,000 short of our whole household here. And I suppose you did that overnight.
Taken 2 years to have done the whole thing, right?
Well, that's an exciting challenge. It's also a good example, though, of having to use technology in your own house. You can't just sell it. Certainly, we're in a situation today where across higher education, lots of things are going on. Someone who has reason to know about that, Alan Oster, is you. You get around the country as an association head. You see an awful lot of different kinds of institutions and what they're doing. I found one of the real problems to be institutional development in terms of how people think about this. And I want to just, before I ask you to comment, I want to just put up some basic issues. For example, if you look at the overall problem in this environment, I don't think it's technology. I don't even think it's admissions. I think it's overall institutional development and thinking holistically about how you approach that. I think that go ahead and put the slide up for me, will you? I think when you look beyond institutional development, you come to the basic opportunity. You know, if this was the basketball age, and it very well may be in Indiana, I'd use basketball as a tool, that's fine. But it's the information age. And I think we need to use those information technologies. That's really the opportunity for institutional development. I think probably competitive advantage gets to be the real issue. I think an awful lot of people would say in higher education, no, that's not really it, except if you watch their admissions procedures, you will see just how competitive they want to get, especially in a down year. And I suppose the whole goal for what we're talking about, Ellen, is or should be excellence in education. If we lose sight of that goal, we're just wasting our time. What do you see in the way of trends around higher education as a whole?
Well, Ray, you use the word holistic, that we look at universities in a holistic way. That's not really the way universities operate. Universities are really a collection of individual scholars. And universities and university professors fundamentally are very conservative. They rely on classroom teaching, on classroom discussions, lectures, and laboratory work. And they're still using, for the most part, that great advance in technology known as movable type that Mr. Gutenberg invented for us, that is the book. Now, of course, we're going beyond that, and the computer is pervasive. We see it throughout the campus. Our professors are using audiovisual materials to a somewhat greater extent than has been true in the past. But the point is that we still have a long way to go to recognize the strategic use of technology in a holistic way, and that is that the campus as an environment has to be tied together in a way that will reinforce the teaching-learning process. But I'm optimistic. I am seeing more movement, and we're seeing examples of it today, of universities that are recognizing and understanding to a much greater extent the use of technology to enhance the teaching, the functions of teaching, research, and public service.
Well, I don't want to dwell on this difference too much, but I think you hit a key point. Universities were designed, developed, and operate as a collection of separated interests, departments, individualized idea-based units, theoretically based units. And I think the toughest thing when you try to do projects like these is you can't do them that way. And we've seen the results of that. This department buys their set of computers and they don't connect with anybody else's computers, and this department wants a telephone system that is simple, doesn't do a thing, but doesn't have anything to do with communication on campus working. This one wants a video system that is, you know, high production. The other one doesn't want anything to do with it. And yet when we try to communicate, we get stuck. Now, I think we have an advantage we're about to get into, and I know a number of the people we're going to talk with throughout the day are going to be interested in this. The ISDN standard, which is going to bring to the desktop voice data and video, but not tomorrow, in the next few years, more than likely. That's probably going to help us to solve some of these problems despite us. It will probably do about what the telephone did to help us to communicate easily. On the other hand, do you see from your experiences, now you came from Wisconsin, I think, to your post, and so you came from that academic environment, an excellent institution with a national reputation. But do you see, as you talk to other academics, some tendency for interdisciplinarity of thought, for holistic thinking about, even from a faculty perspective, about the environment in which they work in?
You're more optimistic, I think, Ray, than I am about
that. You have
to
be to do these projects.
but I do see the opportunity now that technology is bringing us, because individuals can no longer utilize the technology that's available on their own, that it has to be linked together. The library resources, now, at one time, each department had its own, essentially its own library. But now we recognize that when we're talking about the use of film, the use of all kinds of techniques to enhance the learning process, that the span of the professor is enhanced so much by technology that I think our faculties are now ready to a much greater extent to use what is available. But they need people like you, Ray, on a campus to help them see the advantages to them.
Well, one of the things that we found here, and I think I could say the same thing at Pitt, faculty are ready individually. You don't have to do anything magic for faculty. They're bright. They know what they want. They're well-educated. They didn't come to higher education to get rich. They came to do a job that satisfies them. If it's hard for them to get the tools to do, they'll do something else. And I think we've made it awfully hard in some cases for them to get the tools. In other cases, we've given them the tools and not the training. But I think that is beginning to get better, and I'm pleased that's the sense that you get. Let me ask you one final question before we turn to the next member of our panel.
productivity is a dirty word in higher education to some extent. At least that's what I'm told. Tell me what you're told about productivity in higher education.
Well, I think some professors think that when you talk about productivity, what you're saying is let's increase teaching loads and let's try to do more.
Well, that's professor abuse. I know that.
Yeah. Let's try to do more with less.
Yeah.
But when you look at today at the cost of accessing library materials and teaching materials, we know that we have to be much more efficient in the way in which we use those materials. There's another issue here that we have to recognize. By 1995, approximately a third of all the faculty members that we have will be either retiring or leaving for other jobs. And there simply are not enough people in the pipeline now to fill those teaching positions.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to have to use the best talent we have in more effective ways, because the demography is clear. We're going to have an increase in enrollment, although it will continue to vary from time to time. But we don't have those professors, those young people in the pipeline today who want to become professors, and we have to use the resources that we have today in a much more effective way. And technology, I think, is a major tool that we have available to accomplish that.
Well, no matter what you do, you have to make the environment more enjoyable for people and easy for them to work in today's marketplace, because they see other places that are doing it, and if you don't, they'll go someplace else. I think that's just a fair statement. Well, someone who made his environment better, a favorite president of mine, the president of Bradley University, Dr. Jerry Abeck. Jerry, when you were doing the thinking about Bradley's project, surely you had just a little bit more in mind, strategically, I'm talking now, than just putting some technology on campus. You certainly had some opportunities to put technology on campus for years, but you did it as a package, and you did it with your faculty, and you did it with your staff, and you've got a holistic project on campus now. Tell us something about the Bradley project.
Thank you, Ray. We appreciate an opportunity to be a part of this conference and to share our experience. A number of our presidents have talked about the impact it's had on their campus. Let me tell you that the environment on our campus has improved significantly. It has added to the teaching and learning environment significantly and has created for our campus an excitement that we didn't have before. And it all started really with a decision to change our communication system, our telephone system, as Joel outlined before.
That's pretty boring, Jerry. Telephones. I mean, why would a president of the university worry about telephones? I mean, what faculty member would get excited about that?
Well, they get pretty excited if their telephones don't work, let me tell you. And so we decided to explore that. That led us to work with AT&T and the opportunity to visit the Pittsburgh installation, and the rest is history. But let me use the few minutes I have to encourage the institutions of our size that are in the listening audience that have aspirations for these kinds of things, that it's not beyond availability, that you need to use a little ingenuity, you need to get some people in who can provide the incentive and the excitement. And you'll find that it not only will prove to be an asset, but an advantage. And let me share one with you that grew out of our program, which was a rather exciting concept. It was a marketing tool, but it's been successful in helping us maintain the enrollment in our institution, which for an independent institution is important. And that's our residence hall of the future. And we brought along a tape that we'd like to share with the audience.
Ready to roll it? Please, let's roll that tape.
Today, nearly 800 students from varied academic areas are living in one of Bradley University's three residence halls of the future. This successful program has attracted significant student interest in Bradley and has contributed to three consecutive years of increasing freshman enrollment. Early indications for next year show a 43% increase in student applications and deposits attributable to the Residence Halls of the Future program. Each room in the project is equipped with an AT&T 6300 PC, printer, and high-speed network connection, providing students with powerful information processing tools to enhance their academic experience. Every PC is equipped with software for word processing, spreadsheets, graphics, and communications. Perhaps the most significant element of the project is the network link. With every computer connected to the campus AT&T Information Systems Network, students can access the university mainframe, all departmental 3B and VAX computers, and the library online catalog. Services available on the network include electronic mail, electronic teleconferencing, a student bulletin board, a large database of public domain software, and AT&T's Writer's Workbench software for writing assistance. Special attention has been given to the students' need for training and support. In addition to special classes, videotapes can be viewed in students' rooms, over closed circuit television, or in the library. Custom user guides and reference manuals have been prepared, and student computer consultants live on each floor. The Residence Halls of the Future project has been a big success at Bradley, helping our students become better prepared to face the challenges of the information age.
Jerry, what did you really get from the Residence Hall of the Future in terms of admissions? I know you've got some interesting numbers, and I don't want to lose the chance to get those numbers up.
Well, it increased our freshman application
45%. Wait. How many?
45%.
45%?
Yes.
Incredible. And you directly attribute that to that project?
Well, I don't think there's any question. It's been an exciting marketing tool for the university. But more important, I think we've been able to back up with the system that we have. We've been able to back up that advertisement with an on-campus system that responds to the teaching needs of both the faculty and the learning needs of the students.
Well, and that's what these projects should do. They serve the people. Well, I appreciate that. We're going to come back to you in a couple of minutes, but I want to go to another leader. He's been serving as the chancellor of the Oregon State System. He's now the executive vice chancellor. Now that they have just filled the role that he was not contending for, he's done yeoman service of more kinds than I think you could probably count. Bill Lemon is with us from the Oregon System. Bill, you made a decision. You pressed through over years some educating of people. You went through the process of getting to the point of getting started, and you're ready to start a whole system-wide. You're one of the state systems that are doing this. Tell us how you came to that conclusion. You're putting your eggs in one basket to some extent. How'd you come to that decision?
First thing I want to do is take advantage of this opportunity for distance learning and teach you and some other Easterners that O-R-E-G-O-N is pronounced Oregon, not Oregon. But go ahead. With the Oregon State System of Higher Education, Ray, we are in a state which has about 2.6 million people in almost 100,000 square miles of land. So we are rather sparsely settled in many areas of the state. Secondly, we have 8 institutions under one governing board, and as people have mentioned already, within an institution, there's a variety of computing equipment, telephone equipment, other kinds of information systems that exist, and we need to coordinate those not only within the institution, but in our case, among institutions, because we are a system of 8 baccalaureate institutions under a single governing board, and we've been operating that way for 50 years, so it was not a difficult decision to put our eggs in one basket in that sense.
How did you sell the idea to go ahead? I mean, you're talking about a complex system. I've met with your presidents. I've had a chance to see your system. Goodness, you're talking about the legislature, the faculty, campus administrations all around the state. How did you manage to go about the process of getting this done?
We made a lot of mistakes. We assumed that logic and good reasoning would sell. That isn't always the case. We had to do a lot of individual one-on-one kind of counseling, and we did a lot of cost-benefit analyses to look at our information system activities. And of course, we have 2 projects going, Ray. One is the telephone network, which is an interinstitutional network with a switch on each campus, and we'll have fiber optics and other networking among our institutions, but we're also planning what we're calling Oregon EdNet, which is not a higher education facility alone, but will be interactive with us, and it will have downlinks in about 1,000 locations over the state, in high schools, in colleges, in the hospitals, in jails and prisons, and in industry. And our mission there, of course, is to strengthen the infrastructure for education and economics in the state. So the decisions have really focused on, again, as John Smart indicated earlier, the need for interconnectivity, the need to have open architecture. We've insisted on international standards, as those are developing, so that we know that not only our own institutions, but all of these other public and private libraries and other organizations who need access to databases, who need access to all kinds of information, will be able to use our facilities.
Well, certainly our faculties think on a worldwide basis, and I expect we should too in our planning if we're going to support those faculties. And of course, if we don't, why bother to have the faculties in the first place? I've left my boss for last. John Worthen was here just 1 year as president of Ball State University when he was willing to go forward and attempt the Teaching Environment Model Campus of the Future project. John, why after just 1 year in place? Certainly your honeymoon was nearing close. Why take such a project on? Wasn't it very risky to you?
Well, it was risky, Ray, but as you remember, in 1985, when you proposed that we develop Tim Kauf, we had already had approved by the General Assembly the building that we're in and the master's degree in information and communication sciences, and that was moving along. And your proposal to develop this internal communication system seemed to fit right in with what we were deciding at that very time. That would be our long-range goal at the university, to look for ways that we could enhance the educational experience of our students, particularly undergraduate students. And so this opportunity to move voice and data and video, and particularly video, into the classrooms seemed to be very consistent with our goal to become a very strong teaching institution.
Well, one of the things obviously that we talked about was the strategic applications issue and some of the advantages to the institution that we could get. We wanted to create a critical mass here, and that critical mass had to do with not only taking the whole campus on campus and making it a modern environment, but taking this new facility, the building, with all the things within it, making it leading edge, taking an academic program and benefiting it from being in that kind of environment to stay leading edge. And I think probably more than that, as a faculty development tool, to take the faculty and say, we are truly committed to helping you to understand the information age opportunities. We provide faculty development training, and now here's real tools that really do work, so that indeed we're not just giving you empty promises or something that's real and in your hands and available. We talked about some institutional development benefits, and I wanted to go through those. Would you put up the first slide for me, will you? I want to go through some basic benefits that we saw from strategic application of technology on this campus in the 80s, and I think it applies to many others. The first of which just had to do with it being an institutional development issue, one that allows us to look at the whole of the institution, not just at the computer science department or the business college or those places that normally get looked at for this kind of thing. We also wanted to increase access. And John, I think that so many of us, you know, we're using here a student who happens to be handicapped, but so many of us who aren't handicapped, at least in his way, are just as handicapped because we can't get information when we need it. Even college presidents get that problem once in a while. We had the point of improving our learning environment, which is almost obvious now. It wasn't so obvious then by the use of technology. We also were looking at how to improve the work environment. I mean, some of your concerns related as much to staff as it did to faculty to try to make this place work better. We were looking for cost savings. I don't think any one of the gentlemen seated here, could any of you make a decision relative to systems that weren't cost effective to some extent? It would just be folly. I think you would find all kinds of problems, from whether it's a legislative issue or a board of trustees, the same problem would hit. Certainly cost savings is one of the things that we not only wanted but realized. Public attention. There's nothing wrong with seeking some public attention. How else do people know? If you keep your light under a basket, it's very, very hard for people to know what you're doing. So we weren't too shy about asking for that. The showcasing opportunity. And showcasing is one of those interesting things. Certainly today we're showcasing Ball State, Bradley, other institutions. But the advantage of showcasing is as important on your campus to make people believe in what you're doing as it is off campus for people to learn what you're doing. Certainly new economic opportunities, and some of those have come to us already that you'll learn about later. We also wanted to create on this campus a living laboratory for the academic program. Now, those are all things we said we'd do, and finally we said we wanted to put Ball State in a situation to have an opportunity to lead. Jerry Abeg, you'd said the same about Bradley. Basically, you want the opportunity to lead. That's a risk. There's no doubt about it. But John, are you comfortable with that list in terms of being a fairly accurate list in terms of your expectations, and have they been somewhat met?
Yes, I think so. I would certainly say that we have derived benefits in each of those areas. I think also, though, there's another benefit which we are beginning to be more interested in, more excited about, that perhaps we weren't as sure about when we started the project. And I would put that under that rubric of learning or improving the teaching learning situation, but I would focus more on faculty development.
One of the things that we're finding is as we get faculty involved in the distance learning, for example, or in using the opportunity to move voice data and video into the classroom, we're finding that the faculty get excited about this. For example, some of the roll-ins that faculty have developed with our producer directors for use in distance learning, they are now using in their regular classroom teaching here on campus. And the excitement and the opportunity for them to find new ways, new research projects, new ways to teach, new ways to motivate students, and particularly students in a student body such as we have at Ball State, which really ranges all the way from very excellent students in the Honors College to average students to students who in some states would be in community colleges. We have a very diverse student body in terms of academic preparation and ability. And so the opportunity that faculty are seeing to get in the brains of these young people and to motivate them to learn is a benefit that I believe we did not anticipate would be so important as it turns out to be.
Okay, John, let me ask you the other side of this, though. Now, you've given all the positives, and so have I at this point. We don't want to be Pollyanna-ish here. These are no better roses type projects. They take time, commitment, effort, all kinds of things. What was the downside for you as president? I know I aggravated you a fair amount in terms of time, and so did some other people. Give us a little of the downside. What was the tough part of this? You've got some colleagues out there who need to understand that.
Well, I think, I really don't think when you shake it all out that there were a lot of real downside pieces to this project. There were a lot of frustrations, and we took a much longer time, for example, to work out contractual arrangements. We still have to convince the faculty and staff and students that we're not into this simply for the glitz, so that we've got a continuing issue there to deal with. But I think it was not an easy project to implement, but people worked together. They stayed professional, even moving the people into this building. Five different units, all of which wanted this to be their building. That was an interesting project which took place last summer. So I think it's the problems, the downside risk is that you will create some management issues that you have to deal with. But when you finally get it in place and everybody is so pleased, you forget about those. President Abegg talked about the increase in enrollment or increase in admissions. We are experiencing a 58% increase in applications for admission next fall, right now, compared to February of last year. Now, some people have said that's because the basketball team is 18-2, but we think it's probably a combination of a lot of things, including this building and the Timkoff project and the attention that has been brought to the university because of it.
Well, that's marvelous. I'm being told, for those of you who are wondering why I have this strange earpiece, if you're not familiar with all this technology, people are talking to me, telling me we have calls on the line. But before I, be patient out there, we're going to get to you. We're going to start calls in just a couple of minutes. But I want to do a couple of other things, and that is, Dr. Abegg, I want to come back to you. Jerry, downsides from the Bradley Project, advice to your colleagues out there?
Well, the only one I can think of, other than the ones that John has mentioned, and I think we had a few of those, was the concern that the investment was going to, in effect, produce the efficiencies that we're told it would. And in looking back, we needn't be concerned because they did, in fact, produce those efficiencies. They did provide an improved system for the entire campus, and the impact that it's had on our teaching and learning environment is, you have to see it to understand it.
That's marvelous, and as Joel said, they can see it by visiting you, and certainly we welcome them here. Right. Alan, any parting shots before we do a little conclusion and go to the lines?
Well, I would just add that we see technology as one way of conserving scarce resources, and I think we have an obligation to the people who support our universities to make every effort to use the resources well that we have and to find new ways of conserving those resources. We don't see any large amounts of new money coming either from the federal government or state government or even from the private sector. So we have to do better with what we have.
I think we also need to correct a misconception that we look at the demographics and we see a decline in the number of 18-year-olds and we say, well, why are we worried? We aren't going to have as many students. That's not true, because the face of our campuses is changing very dramatically. The 18-year-olds are being replaced by older, by part-time students, by people who see higher education now in very different ways, and people who are homebound, the disabled, the people who are now doing more work at home and need the kind of upgrading of education that this country has to have if we're going to be competitive in the kind of world economy that that we're in. The men and women in the armed services, we have more than 500,000 now taking college courses, people who never even thought about college as being important in their own future lives. So there is much to be done, and I think technology is one very important tool, if we use it correctly and apply it correctly, to help us get the job done.
Oh, I think that's right. You've got to have a certain amount of stick-to-itiveness. John Smart, let me come back to you. Any parting shots here before we go on to the next, or Bill Lemon, or John Worthen?
I'd just say that the population of information technology workers in industry today is just exploding. And I think young people coming out of our colleges and universities today are just going to have such a tremendous advantage, having been able to become familiar with the tools of information technology, to be able to think in the kinds of terms that industries will need to put applications together to improve their competitiveness, improve their markets, improve their productivity. So I just think projects like this, turning out students with these kinds of capabilities, are absolutely essential for American industry.
Bill, any final shot before John?
I think just a couple of things, that these are complex projects, but we have to take the risks. The risk of not doing it is much greater than the risks of doing it. I think that we have to believe what the folks tell us who are analyzing the cost effectiveness of these projects. As Jerry said, that these are proven to be correct, and we simply have to move ahead.
No, I think you're right. John Worthen, we'll give you the honor as our host in closing.
Thank you, Ray. I would just share an anxiety that I have. It's not necessarily a negative, but it's one that I have, and our provost and our deans have. Our commitment is to become a premier teaching university, and this TimCoff system permits faculty to use more visual material in their classroom. Our anxiety is that we will not find ways to be able to encourage them to use the system as much, to use the capability of the system. And we'll lose an advantage, that a benefit that we could have if they do use it. Now, obviously, we're developing workshops for our faculty, and we're trying in a variety of ways to make that, to encourage faculty to use them. But there is that underlying anxiety that we've got this great system, but we somehow won't be able to really make it pay off for us in the improvement of teaching.
Well, I think that's an excellent point. I would suggest from working on the grassroots with faculty, don't worry as much. Not only are they going to use it, they're going to use it more than we can keep up with it. The biggest problem I want to deliver to you is another headache. How do you expand the system? And I want to give you about a year to have to worry about that. We've got some faculty anxious out there and really talented. I think you're going to be happy not continually worried about that particular issue. Let me conclude, and then we're going to go to the phones. We have some folks from Rutgers College, Missouri on the line. We're going to go to them in just a minute. But let me just ask you to put up the slide, if you will. I want to do a little quick conclusion on the goals. This is a strategic application segment. We want to talk about the institutional development goals very briefly. The first one, and perhaps the most important one for all of the things that we're doing, is to simply empower people. There's no point to all this technology if you don't empower people. That's what it's about. We are going to have to redefine cost effectiveness. I think we're going to have to understand about cost effectiveness that if you don't do something, it's going to cost you more than if you do something, and in either case, it's going to cost you more. That's just 1989 and through the rest of this century, I think it's fair to say, if anybody can predict that. We're going to have to rethink productivity. I don't want to waste my time preparing for class. I want to waste my time doing other things. I would like my preparation to be efficient and effective, which means I need access to information that's convenient. And if I'm doing research, it's the same thing. And if I'm doing service, it's exactly the same thing. And that's how this ought to work. I also think that I, as every faculty member, has to keep change as a part of expectation for daily life. You know, it is difficult to have to learn a new phone system or a new computer system, but by golly, we don't have a choice. It's just part of what's going to be there. The more we accept it, the easier it's going to be to do it. And I suppose, finally, the one that I want to dwell on just for one more minute is the improvement of the image of your institution. People understand that projects like these help you to help yourself. If you turn to the slide, and it's very small, and I apologize, but it's out of a newspaper. This is from the New York Times, Best Buys in College Education. It was on the University of Pittsburgh after the Campus of the Future project there. It is an absolute example of how, at that time, an institution, Pitt, which was one of the three most expensive public institutions in America, could suddenly, after the Campus of the Future project became public, begin to be known as one of the best buys in higher education. And why? Because the environment was an environment that was desirable. If you give me the next slide, let's take a look at exactly what we have here. Ball State, in terms of positioning in our own state, and we're all competitive. I mean, we know that we're no Indiana University or no Purdue University, the institutions that are bigger than us in the state in terms of what they have and what we have. Their budgets are much more significant. Our faculty, well, that's a different story. But basically, when you look at what we have with resources, we want people to know more about us. And here we get a nice position from our own state newspaper in Indianapolis, one of the biggest in the state, that simply positions us as a high leap institution moving on to the future. That's the kind of public positioning we want. And if you take a look at the last piece here, it's just simply an advertisement that AT&T had provided on our project in which they positioned us exactly the way we want to. And it simply says, dreams become reality, or vision becomes reality at Ball State. We were willing to have the vision. You allowed it. You followed it. We worked at it, and suddenly we have some reality that we're talking about. Well, all that is wonderful, but if we don't go to the phones, people are going to give up on us, and I think that's what we ought to do. So let me see. This is the first time we're doing this, so we're going to be very careful about it, and I'm going to push up line one. Hello, you're on the air.
Hello.
Hello, please go ahead. Is this Ron McCleary?
Yes, it is.
Ron, please speak up, and who would you like to ask a question to?
Just in general, I would like to hear a discussion of what does the future look like after networking and integration and the current things you're doing out 5 or 10 years?
John Smart, let me throw that one at you. Hot potatoes always go to the guy from corporate America, right? What is the future going to look like in technology?
Well, I think the questioner wants to know more than just technology. I think he's talking about what applications beyond networking. We're currently working on information services digital network that's going to provide all kinds of new integration capabilities at the desk for voice, data, image. As I've looked into the laboratories at what's coming in the next 10 years, it's just a tremendous reservoir of capabilities. But in the final analysis, it's what we do with the technology that's really going to make a difference in solving and meeting the needs that that have come up on the call today. I mean, artificial intelligence is wonderful. We can do wonderful things with it. The Karma Car algorithm is tremendous for linear programming. But in the final analysis, until you apply that to a real problem and a real need, it's just technology.
Would anyone else like to comment on that?
Ray, I would like to say that it seems to us that the revolution in telecommunications technology will impact the way we teach students in the future. In perhaps 10 to 15 years, I would predict that more faculty will become coaches of learning as opposed to simply communicators of information. We'll be giving students information through the technology, and the faculty will be helping those students analyze and synthesize and evaluate and really coach their learning. And I think that will be a major impact in the way we deliver instruction, particularly in colleges and universities.
Well, all right, let's go to the lines. We have Austin College on the line, I believe. Tyrone Gormley is there. Tyrone, do I have you?
Tyrone? I'm here.
Okay, good. What's your question, please? You're on the air.
Well, I teach mathematics at Austin Community College, and I'd like to just ask this in general, the panel, how are mathematics and science faculties using the kind of technologies that you've been talking about in their classroom instruction today? And please be as specific as you possibly can.
Okay.
Thank you.
Question number three.
Let's turn to Gary. Is that one?
The math and science faculty on our campus are using the technology extensively in terms of assignments that are presented to the students to use on their computer. They use the campus communication system to work back and forth with the student. They're also using some of the development techniques in their classroom teaching environment. So I think that the science and technology people have picked up on it as much as anybody on the campus.
Well, all right. Anybody else want to comment on that before we go over to Jackson Community College of Michigan?
John? Ray, let me just mention the distance learning. We are currently teaching physics to high school students. That originates in this building, and it goes out to a number of high schools around the state of Indiana. And we have used the same distance learning approach to teach plane geometry to high school students. And so on the distance learning front, I think we're making considerable progress, and that will continue.
Okay, let's go to line three. Thank you for your call. Line three, we're up in Jackson Community College up in Michigan. Hello, are you there?
Yes.
What's your question? I understand you're worried about intrusion in the classroom.
Right. I'd like to direct my question to Dr. Ulster, if I could. And it deals with the traditional faculty member who says, I am the information source. Technology has no place in my classroom. And how do you deal with that?
Could you hear that all right?
Well, I think we talk about learning resource centers now on our campuses. We used to talk about libraries. I think faculty members are in a situation now where they will have to adapt, and I don't regard it an intrusion. When you have someone on your campus with the professional skills of, a Ray Steele available to you, who can come in and help the professor, any more than a surgeon in an operating room can operate without a great deal of support. And I think when we see what has happened in healthcare, and you can translate that into education, that we need a team approach now to education to a much greater extent than we did before, simply because the transmission of knowledge and the understanding of the world about us has become much more complex.
Well, I think you're exactly right. I think let me add just one thing to that. I think it's awfully important to realize that not every faculty member has to use every tool all the time or any of the time. It must be appropriate for them to do the best job that they do in what they do. Now, it seems to me that if one of my faculty, and I have a faculty that I'm responsible for, if one of my faculty would not use a tool that was essential to doing a good job, he or she wouldn't last as one of my faculty, and I don't think they ought to last anywhere, and I think that same rule ought to be applied to me. On the other hand, you can't force technology on people, and not everybody needs to use it the same way. I think that's where the intrusion ends up being a seduction. I'd much rather deal with the seduction issue, and that is to have people see others use it and begin to say, well, by golly, he or she is doing a better job than I am. Maybe if I try that tool, it'll be a little easier for me to do a better job. I just don't believe that faculty out there want to be average. I've never met a faculty member yet who wanted to be average or mediocre. Consequently, I can't believe they can't be, if they can count on the technology, encouraged to use it. We have a call from Carla Lane out at the University of Missouri. Carla, are you, let's see, I've got to push the button first. Carla, are you on the line?
Yes, I'm here. Our question is, what do you recommend to an urban university to increase our technology funding and merge our technologies given our current budget considerations? We've got funding for video, teleconferencing, but we don't seem to have quite enough to do everything that we need to do. What are the magic words to get the funding?
Well, we're looking for magic words. Jerry, we'll give you a crack at this, and Bill will give you a chance at that, too, because, I mean, both of you are full of magic having done these projects.
Well, I speak from the perspective of an independent institution. John may want to address it from a state institution's point of view, but I think if you look into the money that you're currently investing in your budget in many of these things, you'll find that with the proper technology and by properly allocating the resources, you can do a lot more with that money than is currently being done. At least we found that to be true with our situation at Bradley.
Okay. Bill, you want to add something to that?
Sure. Well, that's exactly what we found, Jerry, also. But there is, of course, an expenditure, a capital expenditure, that has to be made early on. So what we've done is to finance that on a short-term basis and try to schedule the payment of those from a savings over a longer period of time so that we're financing ourselves over 7 to 8 or 9 year period and getting through that big capital blip at the very beginning. But I agree that the savings are there. They're certainly demonstrable, and we think that that's the way we're going to be financing our telecommunications projects.
Well, okay. Let's take another question. Let's see. I think I have another here from Eastern Michigan. George Grimes. Let's try George. George, are you on the line?
Yes, this is George Grimes from Eastern Michigan University. And our question for the panel is, what have these projects done to serve commuting students with particular reference to types of dial-up facilities?
Commuting students. Who's got some commuting students here? Certainly, I think everybody has a commuter here and there. Ball State certainly does. John, we do an awful lot with television. That might be one starting place. Do you want to take that one?
Well, again, we're offering courses live on the campus and simultaneously sending them to other sites in the state of Indiana using the Indiana Higher Education Telecommunications System, which is an optic fiber system that permits us to go to all parts of the state of Indiana. So they are commuting students in one sense, but they don't necessarily have to commute to the main campus.
Well, I think one of the things that we're seeing an awful lot of all over the country, and Ellen, if you've seen this, I'd just give me a cue here and I'll come back to you. I don't want to take your time on it. But I think one of the things we are seeing is the application of distance learning technology is certainly helping the commuter. That doesn't mean they don't come to campus. It means they come to campus when they need to come to campus, and the information comes to them when we can get the information conveniently there, which is, after all, what the information age ought to do. We ought to move and manage information, not shuttle people around and clog the highways.
Ray, I think commuting students will find easier access to library databases, to maps and other things that are on disk, that sort of thing, so that they don't have to return to the campus as often as you suggest.
Well, and we also have found, in terms of what we're doing, let me just tell you one quick story about our commuting students for the MBA program. We are one of the few campuses in the country that does a complete MBA by television. We have tested the results of that over the last 4 years, and in terms of our capacity to do as good a job with the students on campus or off campus, we find the off campus students do consistently just a little better, at least over the last 4 studies. More importantly, we found the student satisfaction level is very high, both on and off campus. They're just treated differently, but they still get contact, they have easy access, they occasionally do come here if they choose to, but it works for either population if you work the technology for the purpose you had in mind, not just for the sake of the technology.
Well, it all started today. The director, assistant director, the technical director, and many other technical and production people working together to see that everything runs smoothly. Their combined efforts have allowed this conference to be seen by thousands of people throughout the world, simultaneously and with interaction. The lights, cameras, sets, graphics, this business of producing a live teleconference may seem difficult and a little confusing to those of you who have not yet done one. As we move further along into the information age, more and more organizations will elect to use the teleconferencing method to educate and train others. A look behind the scenes at the making of a teleconference may prove helpful. Let's spend just a few minutes explaining some of the work that was done which brought this conference to life. This is the master control booth, where the director of our program has been orchestrating the cameras, tapes, and graphics. Working with him is an entire crew of both professional staff, technical support people, students, and engineers, without whom this conference would not be possible. Their work today, as hectic as it has been, is the final act in a series of acts in the process of producing a teleconference. What follows will provide you with a look at how this teleconference was produced, from the planning of the segments, the promotion, the marketing, and finally, the production and the uplink itself.
Sounds pretty simple. Link people together with technology so they can share information. That is the goal of a teleconference. But this simple goal can raise some interesting questions. Who is interested in our topic? How will they even know about the event? Who should we get as panelists and presenters? What telecommunications technology should we use? Can we really do this? It begins with an idea, a story to tell that others will want to hear about that may affect them. And it ends with a live production, a combination of images and ideas presented with the help of technology. In between these two big events, a series of less glamorous events can make or break a teleconference. It does, of course, start with an idea, a topic which is both interesting and important to an audience. Then the work begins. The entire teleconference has to be planned, from the number and length of the segments to the arrangements of guests and speakers. It has to be marketed. The message has to be made known so those interested can make plans to participate. Work on graphics and roll-in tapes have to be completed on time and on budget. The live program must be produced, and the satellite time and uplink arrangements must be made. And finally, there must be follow-up to determine what went right and what went wrong. As with all projects, planning is essential for a successful teleconference. On the day of the conference, dozens of people will have to work in unison for the conference to be a success. This is only possible if everyone knows what has to be done, by whom, and when it must be completed. The first and most important decisions evolve around the topics for each segment and the participants for those sessions.
The way we chose the segments for this conference had to do with how we wanted to process the learning. We started with laying some historic background to take you back so you can understand what the whole concept of the Campus of the Future was about, and then we went from there with the person who created it, me, to the next spot with some of the early users of the concept and began to walk our way through the process of showing models and how people had used the original model to create their own. Now, there we went to some leading edge places, but of course they had to be people who had used the model, and that was of course places like Duke and Bradley, Iowa State. We then went to leadership, and we wanted to show you a broad base of leaders who had made these decisions, and we wanted to use that to help people understand at a leadership level why it might be not only useful but fairly risk-free for them to make decisions about improving their campus. And we went to people who represented good areas. First, a leadership person from AT&T. Second, someone from a major national association. Then we added another major national association for a different population, the junior community colleges, as opposed to the state colleges and universities. And then we went to presidents who actually were on the line themselves. Excuse me just a minute. Yes, Ray Steele.
Ray, this is Dick. Just wanted to pass on a weather update to you.
Yeah.
In regard to the teleconference Tuesday. Yeah, it's looking cloudy, cool, probably high in the 30s or so. But we should be clear.
So there's no precipitation. We don't have to worry about the KU too much.
I believe we're okay.
Thank you, Dick.
You're welcome.
Sorry. As I was saying, we wanted to make sure to get people who represented real doers, and that's why John Worthen, who actually was the leader at Ball State, the same with Bill Lemon, just coming on with the whole state system from a broader perspective, as well as a private institution, Jerry Abeg, president of Bradley. When we got into realities, we wanted to hit the partnership and business issues, and we went to the people who actually had to do it. Glenn Gross, Bernie Surgesketter, people who are in charge for AT&T of making business decisions at that level, and then the vice presidents of business affairs from Ball State and Iowa State, people who had to actually sign contracts. We got into realities, we went to the people who actually put the technology in place at Ball State, both the AT&T people and the Ball State people, so that you could have people who had reason to know, along with the person, myself, the project director, who had actually led the process. But without the real doers, you don't know if someone's just giving you their side of the story. We tried to finish up by looking at the academic opportunity after a question and answer session with the key people, so that you could get a good sense from the academics, talking to academics, who by that time we assumed would be in the audience, exactly how we used what we built to the advantage of the academic program. And of course, we took the people who were doing the video conference and had them participate in the showing you of how we did the video conference.
A teleconference is successful if information is shared with interested parties. The major role in producing a teleconference is to ensure that the word gets out and that potentially interested participants know when and why they should tune in. It is hard, sometimes thankless work, which is both unglamorous and at the same time essential. For this conference, nearly 9,000 pieces of mail were sent throughout the U.S. and abroad in an attempt to reach our selected audience. This mailing was but one part of a market plan designed to see that interested parties were notified. Over 15 months ago, the conference was announced and work began. By October 7th, after a delay in the project due to some technological delays, the date was finalized and representatives of Newton were notified. This notice was followed up with a second notice in December. Simultaneously, work began on sponsor and co-sponsor development. The goal was to get help in the marketing area and to begin to build one of the best marketing tools around, word of mouth. Through these efforts, people around the nation began to learn about the conference. The direct marketing efforts went into high gear in late December and early January. By directing promotional material and fact sheets to opinion leaders of colleges and universities, the filter-down effect increased the likelihood that those interested would find out about the conference. The separate mailings were sent to the President, the Vice President of Academic Affairs, and to the Vice President of Administration and Finance of institutions throughout the nation. Also, Newton representatives and academic unit heads were directly contacted. Since the conference was fully sponsored and thus free of charge, the interested institution simply had to call us and RSVP to register with our office. By keeping the RSVP process simple, the goal was to encourage participation, assure proper information flow, and to develop some commitment. Finally, some national advertising in targeted journals was used to promote the conference. This advertisement was part of the partnership commitment by our sponsor, AT&T.
One of the biggest problems that we have in higher education today is that we eschew the concept of marketing what we do often. And unfortunately, the fewer people who know what we do and receive that information in a fashion that makes it easy for them to understand it and then to take some action based upon it, those people don't participate in education. What we tried to do with marketing is to make it as easy as we could for as large a group of people to understand what it is they might obtain by participating in this video conference. There's nothing wrong with selling a good idea. And I think probably in higher education, more and more, we're going to have to become more and more competitive based upon our capabilities of selling our ideas. To market a video conference is probably one of the single most important things you're going to do after having the idea.
There is a basic rule in television production. It takes longer than it takes. However, with professional staff, encouragement, and the proper tools, remarkable work can be done in a relatively short period of time. While much of a teleconference is open discussion and debate, there are segments which have to be written and produced. Each of these segments are mini productions which require planning, writing, shooting, and post-production work. Getting all of these segments, both live and taped, combined and transmitted, is the final role of the production team. From this control booth, the live and taped segments were selected and uplinked on KU band to SpaceNet 1. This satellite turns it around and offers the KU signal throughout the nation. However, because many institutions receive C-band, the signal is being turned around at the Educational Television Center at Oklahoma State University and returned on C-band on Westar 4 to assure maximum coverage. The many AT&T VBS office receive sites pick up the program on either the KU or C-band signals and convert it for their proprietary system. Finally, to reach Australia, one of AT&T's VBS sites in New Jersey picked up the signal and sent it to their gateway in San Francisco, where it was compressed with a codec and sent to Sydney, Australia. There it was picked up by the Australian OTC and uplinked for receive in the Toowoomba and Brisbane areas in Australia. By using this array of technology, the goal is to transmit to as much of the targeted audience as possible. By using technology, we hope to see that technology itself is not a barrier to the conference. Finally, once this conference is complete, a post-conference debriefing and review of evaluation results will be conducted. Simple evaluation forms have been provided to each site coordinator for completion and return after the conference. We look forward to using these comments from our audience, both formally and informally, to allow us to continue to learn.
To create an environment in which you can apply technology, use it in the learning process while doing. That is the philosophy of the campus of the future. As you have learned throughout the day, all of this technology is now available, and it has helped us to share insights and problems. However, it is essential to remember that our goal and the goal of the campus of the future is not technology for its own sake, but the application of technology to improve communication for people.